All right, then in this lesson, we are going to talk about the blood vessels. So we know the blood vessels, we have arteries, then the capillaries, and then comes the veins. So arteries are the ones which carry oxygenated blood from the heart to the body cells. And arteries, go just to a way to remember arteries is like they start from A. So remember it like this, arteries carry the blood away from the heart, right? And that generally is the oxygenated blood that we talk about. So it takes it away from the heart and then takes it to different body cells. Then veins, okay? They carry deoxygenated blood from the body cells to the heart. So again, veins may, you have this IN, so you can just remember it by it brings the blood back into the heart, okay? So into the heart. Right, so this is what veins do. And then if you look at the artery here, right, so artery, you see it keeps on dividing and branching into arteriole. So arteries divide into arterioles, right? Then these arterioles, if you see, they are branching out into capillaries. Then this gaseous exchange actually takes place at the capillary level. And then what you might be noticing is that these capillaries then start to join up and they form the veneole. And then veneoles join and make up the vein, which then brings back the deoxygenated blood to the heart, right? So again, have a closer look at artery branching off into arterioles, arterioles further branching into capillaries. So capillaries is the area where the gaseous exchange will take place. Then these capillaries will start joining up to make a veneole, and then many veneoles will join to make vein. So talking about arteries in general now, so main function of the artery is actually to transport blood, right? And we are talking about the oxygenated blood. And the main function of it is actually to transport that blood very swiftly and under high pressure to the tissues. So because of this function, is the structure actually enables it to perform this function efficiently. So when we talk about both the arteries and the veins actually, the structure, the walls actually, they are the same. So the walls are made up of three layers. So the innermost layer, okay, the endothelium, it is known as tunica intima, right? So right now we are looking at the artery. So the innermost layer here is the one that this thin layer that you're looking at, okay? So this is the lumen, okay? So the thin layer, the innermost layer that you're looking at here is known as the tunica intima. Then the middle layer, which is known as the tunica media. So this whole layer, this light brown in color that you're looking at is known as tunica media. And tunica media mostly contains the elastic fibers, the collagen fibers, and the smooth muscles, right? And the outermost layer is known as the tunica externa, this one. And tunica externa mostly contains the collagen fibers and some elastic fibers, right? So this is how the structure is, tunica intima, then tunica media, and then the tunica externa. Okay, so these three layers are found in the veins as well. So distinctive characteristics of an artery wall are its strength and elasticity. So basically an artery has more of elastic tissue there because it has to contract, okay, and send the blood under high pressure. So arteries have the thickest walls of any blood vessel, and the aorta is the largest artery, and tunica media by far actually is the thickest part of the wall if we're talking about in terms of arteries, okay? Because this is the difference between the arteries and the veins. Veins have a thinner tunica media. Arteries have a thicker tunica media. It has this elastic walls, okay? And this contains a lot of elastic fibers there, right? So this is the structure of an artery. Then as arteries reach the tissue to which they're transporting the blood, they then branch off into smaller vessels, which are known as arterioles, so we just saw in the previous slide as well. The walls of the arterioles are similar to those of the arteries, right? But they have a greater proportion of a smooth muscle, right? So in an arteriole, we have more of a smooth muscle. So this muscle can contract, narrowing the diameter of the arteriole and so reducing the blood flow. Okay, because again, in the arteries, the blood is coming under high pressure, but as the size actually gets smaller, right? Because the lumen is actually getting narrower and narrower as the artery is dividing into arteriole and finally dividing into capillary. So the blood pressure has to be kept low at that time. So smooth muscles would contract, okay? Because of that, then the lumen will also narrow more, okay? So this will reduce the blood flow. So this helps to control the volume of blood flowing into the tissue at different times, okay? Okay, then coming to the capillaries, up since this is the place where the gaseous exchange will take place and the arterioles will now divide into capillaries, okay? So these capillaries are only one cell thick. So you can look at the capillary here, right? That this endothelium is only one cell thing, and it can only allow one red blood cell to pass through it at a time. So the arterioles themselves, they continue to branch, eventually forming the tiniest of all the blood vessels, which are capillaries. Function of the capillaries is to take blood as close as possible to all the cells, and thus allowing rapid transfer of substances between the cells and the blood. Capillaries form a network throughout every tissue in the body, except the cornea and the cartilage. Such network are sometimes known as capillary beds, right? So here you can look at the size, okay, around 7 to 8 micrometers are size, the diameter of the capillary, and then the red blood cell, which also has a size of around 7 micrometers, it can fit in, okay? So one red blood cell at a time can pass through it, so that oxygen and carbon dioxide can be diffused into another cell, right? Then talking about the veins, as we have already discussed, both arteries and veins have the same three layers, tunica externa, tunica media, tunica interna, right? But then there are structural differences between the two. As the blood leaves the capillary bed and the capillaries gradually join with one another, forming larger vessels for the venules, and the venules join to form the veins. The function of veins is to carry blood to the heart, which is deoxygenated blood mostly. But if you look at the lumen, the lumen of the veins is more wider. Okay, so you can look at the lumen here. It's more wider as compared to the artery. Right? What else is there in a vein? Veins also carry this one-way valve. Okay, so as the blood is going against the gravity, actually, to the heart. Okay, so these have one-way lumens, one-way valves are there in the veins, which are not found in there in the arteries. Okay, then tunica media, if you look at the tunica media is a thick layer in the artery, but it's a thinner layer here in the veins. Right, and then you can look at the tunica externa as well. Okay, so this is a difference between the artery and a vein. So this is another diagrammatic view. So here, if you look at the tunica intima, okay, it is just like that of the artery. But if you look, focus on the tunica media, this part here, this is very thin and it contains like a small number of smooth muscle elastic tissues as compared to the artery. If I can again actually show you how the artery looks like. So see, it has a thicker tunica media. Artery, but the vein has a thinner tunica media. Okay, then comes the tunica externa, which has many collagen fibers. Okay, you can look at the lumen, it is quite wider as compared to the artery. So maintaining high blood pressure is the main force that drives the blood from the heart around the body. So when we talk about the heart contraction, which is known as systole, so during heart contraction, the blood is pumped from the left ventricle to the aorta, and then from the aorta as it branches off to different arteries, okay, to different parts of the body, but this blood is being actually pumped under very high pressure. Okay, so this is the systemic circulation that we're talking about. Blood from the heart goes to different parts of the body, except the lungs. So right now we're talking about the left ventricle mostly. The elastic fibers of the arteries enable them to expand and allow the blood through. Okay, during diastole, which is the heart relaxation, the blood pressure in the artery drops because now the heart is being filled with the blood. The elastic recoil of the artery walls help force the blood on. Then as the blood moves to a smaller arterioles into the capillaries and then the venules and veins, its velocity and pressure drops continuously, right? So here you can actually look at, okay, when during systemic circulation, okay, when the blood is at the aorta, is in the highest pressure, okay, around 100 to like 110, 120, that blood pressure hota hai yahan pe. Okay, then you can see, okay, because this elastic contraction hoti hai arteries ki, so you can see, okay, the blood pressure remains high. Okay, aorta say when it goes into the arteries, but then eventually you see, okay, as it moves into the arterioles and then the capillaries and then the venules, so you can see, okay, how the blood pressure drops. Okay, in the capillaries you can see, okay, like it's around like 20 millimeters of mercury. Okay, and then it drops even more when it's there in the venules and veins. Okay, and then through the vena cava, when it comes into the right side of the heart, right atrium, and then from the right ventricle, it is pumped into the pulmonary arteries. So this is where the pulmonary circulation is. So you can actually see the difference now, because arteries, they would contract, they would increase the blood pressure, but not as much as compared to the systemic circulation. Okay, so when the blood is pushed from the left ventricle to the aorta, and then to the arteries to be sent to the rest of the body, so you can look at the pressure. Okay, but since look at the pulmonary pressure here. So, okay, so pulmonary pressure has a low pressure, and then the main reason is here because gaseous exchange will actually, because in lungs, like we have to keep the pressure low. Okay, because, and then again, pulmonary arteries are divided into arterioles and then capillaries. The pressure has to be kept low there. Okay, and then finally, venules, Then the pulmonary veins will bring back the oxygenated blood back to the auricles or atrium, then into the left ventricle, then the left ventricle will push the blood again into the atrium. Then you can see the increased pressure here. Because the systemic circulation has this increased pressure, pulmonary circulation has this decreased pressure there. Okay, then the next topic is blood plasma and the tissue fluid. So our blood is composed of cells which are floating in this pale yellow liquid called plasma. ठीक है, सो ब्लड जो होता है एक्चुअली द ब्लड कॉम्प्लेक्स एक्चुअली इन अ सस्पेंशन. ठीक है, दे आर सस्पेंडेड इन दिस प्लाज्मा. प्लाज्मा इज अ पेल लाइक येलो लिक्विड दैट कॉन्स्टिट्यूट्स अराउंड 55% ऑफ द ब्लड. सो ब्लड प्लाज्मा इज मोस्ट ऑफ इट इज वाटर. ठीक है, बट इट हैज डिसॉल्व सब्सटेंसेस इन इट. व्हाट आर द सब्सटेंसेस आर देयर इन द ब्लड प्लाज्मा? सो दीज सॉल्यूट्स आर मोस्टली ग्लूकोज. ठीक है, वेस्ट प्रोडक्ट्स सच एज यूरिया दैट आर बीइंग ट्रांसपोर्टेड फ्रॉम वन प्लेस टू अनदर इन द बॉडी. Solutes also include protein molecules called plasma proteins that remain in the blood all the time, right? So these components are there in the blood plasma. Even when we talk about carbon dioxide, as it diffuses out of the cells, okay, so it goes into the plasma, okay, then it diffuses out of the plasma into the lungs, okay, and then is exhaled. So, okay, so this plasma contains these dissolved substances, right? So there's glucose. It has waste products. It has certain hormones as well. Okay, whenever they are there in the system, so chemicals would be there as well, right? Besides that, solutes also could include protein molecules called plasma proteins. They remain in the blood all the time. As the blood flows through the capillaries within the tissues, some of the plasma leaks out through the gaps between the cells in the walls of the capillary, right, and seeps into the spaces between the cells of the tissue. Okay, so we know as these contents they have to release from the capillaries and they go into the tissue. Okay, but what they do, the plasma leaks out through the gaps between these capillary cells. Okay, because so capillary already one cell thing, plasma leaks out, and as the plasma leaks out, it has those dissolved components in it as well. Right, so it seeks into the spaces between the cells of the tissues. Almost 1/6 of your body consists of spaces between your cells. Okay, so there are spaces between the cells. And these spaces are filled with this leaked plasma, which is known as tissue fluid. All right. So when we talk about blood, so remember it's a specialized transport medium, and it is also considered a specialized type of connective tissue. And in a given time, your body has around 4 to 6 liters of blood circulating, right? So blood has a range of functions, not just transportation of nutrients within the cells and around the body, right? But also the defense, as these white blood cells, okay, they are also a part of the blood. Okay, they're involved in thermoregulation as well as maintaining pH of the body fluids. So these are all the functions of blood. So if you look at the composition of blood, like it consists of around 55% plasma. So the yellow part that you're looking at here. Okay, so it contains around 55% of plasma, and around 45% of it is these components, which are the formed elements, red blood cells, white blood cells, the platelets, right? So this plasma actually contains most of it is water, right? But besides that, it also contains plasma proteins. So this plasma itself can contain around 8% of plasma proteins, and of these plasma proteins, around half of albumins. Half of them are albumins. Okay, we have other plasma proteins as well, but it can be 8%. Maybe there are half of them which are albumins, right? And these are a small group of proteins which transport other substances such as fatty acids, hormones. Okay, and they also help to regulate the osmotic pressure of the blood. So this is what we'll talk about in a while. So in the capillary, there is this balance maintained between the hydrostatic pressure of the blood. That hydrostatic pressure of the blood is actually the blood pressure. Okay. So this blood pressure is actually maintained around the arterial end of the capillary, because if you remember, the arteries divide into arteriole, then arterioles divide into capillaries, and capillaries join back into venules and then form the veins. So the capillary at the artery end, which is arteriole basically, it has higher pressure there, because arteries, the blood flows into the arteries under high pressure. Okay, so there's high pressure over there, right? And like if you look at the venous end there, in that end the osmotic pressure has to be maintained. So we'll see how this happens, right? So osmotic pressure has to be maintained at the venous end. So it at that place the pressure is low. Okay, so this is what is important, the formation of tissue fluid. So let's just see how this happens. So if we focus on this part here, if this is like artery, arterial, then capillaries, venule, and vein. If we, let's say, divide it into halves, right? And we know, okay, these tissues, actually the capillaries are there in the tissue. So let's say these are different cells there, right? So what happens is that since the blood pressure is more here at the arteriolar end, this is the artery, the blood comes under high pressure, then comes the arteriole, okay? And then the arteriole as it branches into capillaries. So this artery end, the arteriole end of the capillary has a high blood pressure, right? So because of the high blood pressure, and since the lumen here is narrow, the capillary is already one cell thick. So because of this constant pressure here or high pressure here, the plasma fluid will leak out of the capillaries, right? Now the capillaries walls are as such that plasma can flow out. Definitely plasma contains mostly water, right? But what happens, these solutes, the larger solutes, they remain inside the blood. So these plasma proteins, right, they're bigger in size, they cannot leak out of the capillary, so they would stay there, right? So what is happening, because the water is being leaked out, or the plasma actually rather is being leaked out. So what happens because of that, the water potential here becomes low. Okay? So water potential becomes low, there's a negative water potential now because water has plasma has left. And now what happens, the solute potential is high because we have these proteins here, right? So what happens because of now, as this plasma or this blood actually, rather now leaves this capillary and goes into the venous side. What happens now, since there are plasma proteins here already in the system, what will happen now, water will enter the capillary. Okay, and this will enter because of osmosis. So this is known as osmotic pressure because now we have more proteins there inside. So water will come in at the venous end, and this is where actually it is at low pressure. Okay, so under high pressure, plasma leaks out of the capillary. Okay, but as it leaks out, the plasma proteins, which are larger in size, they stay in. Okay, so the pressure is high here, but as it moves towards the venous end, what happens now? Because the proteins are already there in the capillaries, okay? With the blood, the solutes are more. So water will flow in because of osmosis. So this is the osmotic pressure, and this reduces the blood pressure there. Okay, so these cells actually, as we know, get the plasma as it leaves the capillaries. Okay, it actually, this surrounds these cells. Okay, so these actually, they're constantly bathed in the plasma. And the same plasma, as it leaves the capillaries and it goes there into the tissues, so we call it as a tissue fluid. So tissue fluid is nothing, it's simply the change of place now. Okay, when it was there in the capillaries, it was known as a plasma. Okay, when it is left the capillaries, now we are calling it as a tissue fluid. So okay, there's no change as such in the composition there. Okay, so this is known as tissue fluid. But what is happening, 90% of the plasma returns back at the venous end. Okay. So the one that left the arterial end of the capillary went into the tissue fluid, diffusion happened, and then as it is coming back, okay, so 90% of this is returns back. Okay, the remaining 10% actually comes back through an alternate route of circulation, which is known as the lymphatic system. Okay, so 10% does not return back to the capillaries, but it undergoes another pathway, which is known as the lymphatic pathway. So as you can even look at this table as well, okay, as you were saying, okay, in the formation of tissue fluid, remember, is the same plasma which has left the capillaries, okay, at the arteriolar end or artery end. So the blood plasma and the dissolved substances move out of the body cell. So we saw that, okay, because the pressure is more. So blood plasma and the dissolved substances, they move out. The table here shows the relative permeability of the substances in the blood. So you can see water, okay, is highly permeable. Water can leave. Plasma has a lot of water there. Okay, sodium ions, urea, okay, glucose. So you can look at the permeability, but look at albumin, hemoglobin, these are all protein. So then look, they're like, they cannot leave the capillaries as such. Okay, so they're not as such, the capillary walls are not permeable to them, so they stay there. Okay, even if it's hemoglobin, the oxygen will diffuse out of it. Okay, oxygen will diffuse out and go into the tissues and go into the cells. Okay, but hemoglobin, these proteins, they stay there, right? So the tissue fluid allows the body to easily and quickly move dissolved molecules out of the body cells and take away the waste materials back into the blood. Okay? But remember, we were talking about two types of pressure. The hydrostatic pressure is there at the artery end. Osmotic pressure is there at the venous end. Okay? So hydrostatic pressure is the blood pressure. It is higher. Okay? When the blood is coming in from the arterioles into the capillaries, and because of the high pressure, and since the capillaries are one cell thick, it forces the plasma out of the capillaries through the endothelium onto the body cells. Okay, so this happens at the arterial end. Then coming to the osmotic pressure, since the proteins, okay, they remain inside. So what is happening? The removal of blood plasma causes a decrease in the water potential of the blood. As a result, water moves back into the capillaries by osmosis. Okay, so osmotic pressure happens at the venous end, right? And then we were discussing about the lymph as well. So around 90% of the plasma then returns back, or the tissue fluid actually, it returns back from the capillaries, but the remaining 10% is what we call as lymph. Ab wahi tissue, wahi plasma hai, but theek hai, but since it is there, it is not returning back to the capillaries and it is going to the lymphatic system, we will refer to as lymph. So again, it depends upon their different positions. So wahi plasma jab capillaries ke andar hai, we call it plasma. ठीक है, वेर इट इज देयर इन द टिश्यूज तो हम उसको बोलते हैं टिश्यू फ्लूइड. ठीक है, एंड वेर इट इज देयर इन द लिम्फेटिक सिस्टम वी वुड कॉल इट लिम्फ. ठीक है, सो अगेन इट्स सिंपली बिकॉज कि उनकी पोजीशनिंग डिफरेंट है, राइट? सो दीज अ सीरीज ऑफ ट्यूब्स व्हिच आर नोन एज लिम्फेटिक सिस्टम्स और लिम्फेटिक वेसल्स एक्चुअली दे आर सॉर्ट ऑफ ए लाइक अ बैकअप रूट फॉर ब्रिंगिंग इन द रिमेनिंग 10% ऑफ दिस टिश्यू फ्लूइड और लिम्फ बैक टू द हार्ट. So lymphatics are tiny and these are blind adding vessels which are found in almost all the tissues of the body. Okay, so you can look at the parts here. Okay, so thoracic duct, thymus. Okay, see, these are all lymphatic like organs that you see, spleen. Okay, so we have these lymphatic vessels and lymphatic nodes there in the lower body as well. Okay, but all of them actually then drain at the cervical or at the subclavian veins actually. ठीक है, सो अगेन आई विल शो यू. सो दी सबक्लेवियन वेज एक्चुअली आर बिलो द क्लेविकल. सो ऑल ऑफ यू मस्ट नो द क्लेविकल. क्लेविकल इज अ कॉलर बोन. ठीक है, इसके नीचे ही वेज होती है विच वी कॉल देम एज सबक्लेवियन वेन. सो जितना भी लिम्फेटिक वेसल्स है दे आर ड्रेनिंग फ्रॉम योर बॉडी एंड दे आर कमिंग फ्रॉम द लोअर पार्ट ऑफ द बॉडी दे आर कनेक्टिंग फ्रॉम द डिफरेंट जो ग्रीन डॉट्स जगह जगह आपको नजर आए दीज आर ऑल लिम्फेटिक नोड्स. सो दे कलेक्ट फ्रॉम लाइक फॉर एग्जाम्पल दीज आर एक्सिलरी लिम्फ नोड्स. These are lymphatics of the upper limb, inguinal lymph nodes. So they collect from all the parts of the body, but they then drain into the subclavian vein. And the subclavian vein would eventually join the vena cava, okay? And then it will drain into the right side of the heart, right? So these lymphatics, they are tiny blind adding vessels which are found in almost all the tissues of the body. Okay, they contain tiny valves which allow the tissue fluid to flow in, but stop it from leaking out. Okay, so they have valves, so tissue fluid would flow in them, okay, but they would not leak out. They will stay there. So the fluid inside the lymphatics is known as lymph, as we have talked already. So lymph is virtually identical to the tissue fluid. I just said that it's simply the change in their positioning. Okay. So now they are not in the tissue anymore. They are the lymphatic system. We have called lymph mold. It is a different name more because it is at a different place and because it is a different composition. So I hope you understand what this lymph is, right? So this lymph is a colorless pale yellow fluid similar to the tissue fluid, okay, but it contains more lipids in it. The lymphatic system drains into the circulatory system near the vena cava via the thoracic duct, and remember the vein that is involved is subclavian vein. Now this lymphatic system has also known as a secondary circulatory system, okay, and as we just saw, it drains the extra or the remaining 10% of the tissue fluid into the heart. But besides that, it also serves as a part of the major immune system as well. So this lymphatic system consists of lymphatic capillaries, okay? And it also has these vein-like lymph vessels which contain the valves, right? It contains lymph nodes. These lymph nodes are actually sac-like organs that trap the pathogens and foreign substances and which contain a large number of white blood cells, right? So this is how it also helps in your immune system. So lymphatic tissue, okay, mostly spleen, thymus, tonsils, okay, these are the lymphatic tissue. So what they do, they contain large amount of white blood cells, okay, and are involved in the development as well, okay. So like these structures, they have white blood cells, okay, pathogens get trapped there, they get destroyed, okay. So here actually, if you see, you're looking at the subclavian vein. So they have shown you the left subclavian vein, the right subclavian vein, these veins here that you see, right, and then they drain via the superior vena cava into the right side of the heart. So see, they're joining. So they bring all the lymphatics or lymph from the different parts of the body and it drains here. Right, so importance of lymph: tissue fluid flows into the lymphatic system through the valves and the nodes. Okay, so it enters through the valves and the nodes. Okay, so valves are even larger enough to allow large protein molecules to pass through. Okay, so valves here are large enough. ठीक है, व्हेन द लिम्फ सिस्टम यू लाइक इफ देयर इज नो लिम्फेटिक सिस्टम बिकॉज़ यू सी इट्स अ पार्ट ऑफ द इम्यून सिस्टम and the additional fluid we keep on like depositing there, so it's difficult for the person to survive as well, right? So this would, because this would lead to build up of tissue fluid in the tissues, and this is called edema. Okay, the body does not want to actually retain water there. Okay, it has to be removed, right? So as we just discussed, okay, these capillary walls, they're not very permeable to plasma proteins. So a plasma protease, if they are found in the tissue fluid, okay, so you know, okay, they will be there because of the lymph, okay, because lymph can actually make these plasma proteases enter them. So lymphatic system contains the white blood cells, they contain the phagocytes and lymphocytes, as well as transporting water, the plasma. Lymphatic system plays an important role in the secondary defense system. Okay, so this much about the lymphatic system, and in the next lesson, we'll talk about the internal and internal structure of the heart, basically, and how the cardiac cycle works, how to read the ECG, how the heart muscle coordinates. So we'll talk about that in the next lesson. Okay? Thank you then.